can voluntary repatriation work?
We'll have to look at what's meant by voluntary. I know at first blush, voluntary and compulsory seem to be perfectly straightforward, simple expressions opposite the one to the other. But let me just ask one question. Suppose it were decided that those who had dependents still abroad could not claim tax relief on their behalf. Now, no doubt, that change, an administrative change which would bring our tax law into line with that of many other countries, would greatly stimulate the propensity to accept assistance with repatriation.
Persuasion?
Now, I see. So you regard that as voluntary?
Persuasion, I put to you.
So that's voluntary. You class that as voluntary?
Well, persuasion or intimidation?
Well, you tell me. I want to know what you mean by voluntary. And I've given you an example of a government policy which would undoubtedly increase the propensity to accept assisted repatriation. Now, is that to be classed as voluntary repatriation?
No, I would term that as an inducement to accept.
And you regard that as voluntary?
No.
You ask me whether I have in mind voluntary or compulsory. And therefore, I must know what it is that you regard as voluntary. Now, I want you to tell me whether that would be voluntary repatriation.
No, I would think that would be intimidation.
Oh, I see. So, any policy which does not place every inducement before those who are here to remain here is, in your opinion, compulsory repatriation.
Well, what is your motivation for bringing in such legislation? Why are you suggesting that that should happen?
I'm suggesting it because if it is public policy that in order to avert evils which threaten all, including the immigrants, the prospective future size of the immigrant population shall be reduced, then the government would, in such matters as taxation, naturally and logically behave not on the assumption that this is a population permanently domiciled here, but that it is a population only temporarily domiciled here. And I gave you an example of it. And therefore, I'm pointing out that to talk about voluntary and compulsory as though they were single alternatives, monolithic alternatives, is nonsense.
Can I then ask you why anyone...
You've gone off that, then.
Well, if you wish to continue with the discussion.
Yes, I see.
How would you define compulsory?
Compulsory, in the sense in which this term is used, I'm sure that the sense which it conveys to the general public is that a person would be physically seized and deported like a person being taken on board Majesty's ships of war at the end of the 18th century.
So where would you draw the line, Mr. Powell?
I draw it short of that.
How far short?
But we have to remember that on the other side there is the alternative. We have to remember that we are making a choice of necessities, a choice, if you like, of evils, though to return to one's own country does not, to most people, though it may to some, appear to be an evil. But on the other side, there is a certain evil, and that is an evil as fearful for the immigrant population as it is for the rest. And that is bound to influence one's view of the public policy, which is justified as a means of increasing the readiness of the population to take advantage of what is offered.
But if they will not go back, quote, voluntarily, unquote, how are you going to induce them to go back,
I want to see what will be the consequences over 5 or 10 years of a series of public policies such as I outlined in my speech.
But a gradually increasing inducement, intimidation.
I don't think it's intimidation to tell a man that he doesn't get tax relief for dependents not in this country.
You're talking about moving 1 million people over 5 years, Mr.
Yes,
Powell. That's 200,000 a year.
That's nothing.
Do you seriously think that voluntary repatriation is going to make 200,000 people a year leave this country?
It seems to me perfectly possible.
Do you seriously think that £1,000 is going to induce an immigrant...
£1,000 per head?
Yes, is going to...
That's 5,000 for a man and wife and three
is going to induce a man to leave his home, the home that he's bought in this country?
Yes, I know.
The home in which he has lived perhaps for 15 years?
I know very many such cases.
You're confident of that?
I don't know how many, but we have no means of knowing. Because, remember, for the last 25 years, the whole atmosphere, all the pressure of opinion, all the pressure of government has been to say, this is permanent.
But what if they don't go? What if 200,000 people every year don't go, to keep up to your schedule?
I will wait and see.
But you can't
prepared.
Say. I mean, you must have thought it through, Mr. Powell.
Are you saying that a nation should not engage in a war, a defensive war, or that a general should not commit his troops to battle unless he has decided in advance what he is going to do, or they are going to do, if they are defeated?
He would be a poor strategist if he hadn't. He might be quite a good tactician.
I can't imagine that one initiates a policy upon the basis of deciding in advance what one will do if it fails.
To where would you repatriate those immigrants who were born here?
To where they wanted to go. In most cases, they are the citizens of their countries of origin, although born in this country.
40% of the total immigrant population, I think, were born in this country.
Yes, a high proportion of those are citizens of their countries of origin, under the laws of their countries of origin. So I'm dealing with the question of a legal difficulty, in that there isn't a legal home any longer.
Now, you describe it as their home in your
speech. Yes, of course it is.
They've never seen it, of course.
Well, an Englishman born to missionaries in China is still an Englishman.
We're not talking about those numbers. We're talking about a lot of people, Mr. Powell.
Quite so. But we are talking about them individually. Yes. Now, let's go back to my Englishman, the second generation born of missionaries in China. His home is England. He's always thought it's his home.
Even though
no one would doubt that it was his home. His home certainly isn't China. Unless, indeed, he has opted out of his citizenship and opted out of his attachment.
Now, how would you deprive these people born here of their British citizenship?
I don't know what you mean by British citizenship.
Well, they believe that they're British, you see, and they're born here, and therefore they would argue that this is their home.
Well, they don't argue that this is their home. The majority of them regard India or Jamaica or wherever it may be as their home. It is simply unrealistic to pretend that these people born here in increasingly massive numbers regard this country as their home. Because they are born in this territory, our law, which has a feudal basis, treats them, as it were, as the product of the soil and appropriates them. They are born within the dominion. But in the eyes of the law of their own countries, they are citizens of their countries of origin.
They hold a passport, Mr. Powell, which says British subject and citizen of the United Kingdom and colonies.
And they also have the right to hold a passport of their country of origin.
But they hold a British passport.
No, it depends which passport they apply for.
Well, they hold a British passport.
They are entitled to a British passport. But I do wish you would cease to be so inhuman as to treat this as a matter of a travel document which a person holds, and pay attention to the humane and deep meaning of the concept of home. And what I have to tell you is that for these people, it is insulting to tell them that this country is their home. It is as insulting as it would be to tell an Englishman born of English parents in India that therefore India and not England is his home. Readiness of the population to take advantage of what is offered.
But if they will not go back, quote, voluntarily, unquote, how are you going to induce them to go back,
Mr.
Powell?
I want to see what will be the consequences over 5 or 10 years of a series of public policies such as I outlined in my speech.
But a gradually increasing inducement, intimidation.
I don't think it's intimidation to tell a man that he doesn't get tax relief for dependents not in this country.
You're talking about moving 1 million people over 5 years, Mr.
Yes,
Powell. That's 200,000 a year.
That's nothing.
Do you seriously think that voluntary repatriation is going to make 200,000 people a year leave this country?
It seems to me perfectly possible.
Do you seriously think that £1,000 is going to induce an immigrant?
£1,000 per head?
Yes, is going to...
That's 5,000 for a man and wife and three dependents.
Is going to induce a man to leave his home, the home that he's bought in this country?
Yes, I know.
The home in which he has lived perhaps for 15 years?
I know very many such cases.
You're confident of that?
I don't know how many, but we have no means of knowing. Because, remember, for the last 25 years, the whole atmosphere, all the pressure of opinion, all the pressure of government has been to say, this is permanent.
But what if they don't go? What if 200,000 people every year don't go, to keep up to your schedule?
I will wait and see. I will wait and see.
But
I'm not
prepared.
You can't
say. I mean, you must have thought it through, Mr. Powell.
Are you saying that a nation should not engage in a war, a defensive war, or that a general should not commit his troops to battle unless he has decided in advance what he is going to do or they are going to do if they are defeated?
He would be a poor strategist if he hadn't. He might be quite a good tactician.
I can't imagine that one initiates a policy upon the basis of deciding in advance what one will do if it fails.
To where would you repatriate those immigrants who were born here?
To where they wanted to go. In most cases, they are the citizens of their countries of origin, although born in this country.
40% of the total immigrant population, I think, were born in this country.
Yes, you and send a high proportion of those are citizens of their countries of origin, under the laws of their countries of origin. So I'm dealing with the question of illegal.
Can voluntary repatriation work?
We'll have to look at what's meant by voluntary. I know at first blush, voluntary and compulsory seem to be perfectly straightforward, simple expressions, opposite the one to the other. But let me just ask one question. Suppose it were decided those who had dependents still abroad could not claim tax relief on their behalf. Now, no doubt, that change, an administrative change which would bring our tax law into line with that of many other countries, would greatly stimulate the propensity to accept assistance with repatriation.
Persuasion?
Now, I see. So you regard that as voluntary?
Persuasion, I put to you.
So that's voluntary. You class that as voluntary?
Well, persuasion or intimidation?
Well, you tell me. I want to know what you mean by voluntary. And I've given you an example of a government policy which would undoubtedly increase the propensity to accept assisted repatriation. Now, is that to be classed as voluntary repatriation?
No, I would term that as an inducement to accept.
And you regard that as voluntary?
No.
You ask me whether I have in mind voluntary or compulsory. And therefore, I must know what it is that you regard as voluntary. Now, I want you to tell me whether that would be voluntary repatriation.
No, I would think that would be intimidation.
Oh, I see. So any policy which does not place every inducement before those who are here to remain here is, in your opinion, compulsory repatriation.
Well, what is your motivation for bringing in such legislation? Why are you suggesting that should happen?
I'm suggesting it because if it is public policy that in order to avert evils which threaten all, including the immigrants, the prospective future size of the immigrant population shall be reduced, then the government would, in such matters as taxation, naturally and logically behave not on the assumption that this is a population permanently domiciled here, but that it is a population only temporarily domiciled here. And I gave you an example of it. And therefore, I'm pointing out that to talk about voluntary and compulsory as though they were single alternatives, monolithic alternatives, is nonsense.
Can I then ask you why anyone...
You've gone off that, then.
Well, if you wish to continue with the discussion.
Yes, I see.
How would you define compulsory? You see,
well,
I'm wondering...
Compulsory, in the sense in which this term is used, I'm sure that the sense which it conveys to the general public is that a person would be physically seized and deported like a person being taken on board Majesty's ships of war at the end of the 18th century.
So where would you draw the line, Mr. Powell?
I draw it short of that.
How far short?
But we have to remember that on the other side, there is the alternative. We have to remember that we are making a choice of necessities, a choice, if you like, of evils, though to return to one's own country does not, to most people, though it may to some, appear to be an evil. But on the other side, there is a certain evil, and that is an evil as fearful for the immigrant population as it is for the rest, and that is bound to influence one's view of the public policy, which is justified as a means of increasing the